You may be hating the waiting at this particular moment. It's hard to wait, but we have to remember that God is a God of compassion, and He's in control. Let's go to Him right now in prayer. Father God, we're hating the waiting at this moment. We're waiting. The pain is there. The hurt is there. The need is there. Come, Lord, come. Teach us how to wait, even while the plow is doing its work, that we can believe You and wait for the miracles to follow. In Jesus' name, amen. When we look in the Word of God, we see a lot about waiting. And we see that how critical it is that we do wait. Let's take a look at the Word of God. Let's open it up at this time and remember that God's delay is not God's denial. For Lamentation 3:25 tells us that the Lord is good to those whose hope is in Him, to the one who seeks Him. You can still have hope in the midst of hopelessness and despair as you draw upon the Word of God and see that God cares about you deeply. Look at Psalm 111. Verse 4, where it says, He has made His wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious, merciful, and full of loving compassion. In order to receive this loving compassion, we have to learn how to wait, even when the plow is working in our lives. What I mean by that is that as fallow ground sitting there, the plow each spring has to go down and it has to turn the ground over and get ready to plant the seed. Well, it's painful when that happens in our life. But yet, we're clearly told in the Word of God, in Hosea chapter 10, verse 12, break up your fallow ground, for it's time to seek the Lord until He comes to rain righteousness on you. It's the plow of trials and tribulations that break up the fallow ground of complacency, apathy, sleepy contentment, and breaks it up, turns it all over, and cultivates the field to the point that the seed can be planted. And then we're reminded that we need to wait and reap the harvest. It's a person who feels the pain of change that often has the hardest time to wait. And maybe you're one of those. You know, maybe your life has been turned upside down, inside out. There seems to be one tragedy after another. And as you're getting older, you find yourself becoming increasingly bitter rather than better. And what do you do? Well, you don't. The last thing you want to do is to feel the pain. You're trying to avoid the plow at all costs, and you're sick and tired of going through all these trials and tribulations. So what do? You revert to spending a lot of time in memories of things happening in the past, that when you went through the plow and weren't even realizing at the time the miracles that followed, the good things that followed. God wants to do those same good things in your life at this particular time if you can wait and watch for the miracle following the plow. And that's why we need to get into God's Word and hear what He has to say to us. Because He actually tells us in Galatians chapter 5, 22 and 23, that miracle fruits that result from this plowing, so to speak, in our life, the hurt, the pain, the miracle fruits of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It says there's no law against all of that. And we can experience that miracle work and those fruits as we do this. Now, in those unfruitful times in my life, or the times in which I get tired of the struggle, I refuse to wait for the miracles. I only want a life of peace and security. And it's then that I find myself, again, getting busy, dwelling on the memories of the past, happier times. And man, we get totally caught up in that. And we start living so much in the past, we're not living and experiencing the miracle of the God of the now. And then we're not waiting for Him. We say, well, I'm getting old. I can't do the stuff I did earlier. But that was a liar. Look what God did in Abraham's life. He heard the promise. He waited on God, and God made him a father of a great nation. And look what happened to Moses. You know, and by the way, Abraham was 100 when he had that child. Moses was 80. Yeah, Moses, 80 years old, he thought he's going to live out his life. No more problems, no more plows, no more disruptions. And God speaks to him in a burning bush. Next thing you know, his whole life is turned upside down. And God is just beginning to do a mighty work. So don't give up. Maybe you're 80, 100, or whatever it may be. Stop telling yourself you're too old, because this can be the first day of the rest of your life. You and I can be reinvigorated day by day. We don't need to retire. We need to get refired and do it exceedingly abundantly beyond what God is. We can't even ask or think, because He's a mighty God. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same miracles He did in the past in our life, He can do right now. So the question is, are we going to be able to hear what He's having to say to us? In this case, in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3 says, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come and will not tarry. All right, let's take a little deeper look at that verse there. On the one side, it says it's for an appointed time. Another time, it says it's going to come. So what does it mean? It means that we actually need to realize that God has an appointed time. We're going through this very difficult period. We can't make it go any faster, and all our effort, what we do is prolong it. Ask the children of Israel. They should have been in a matter of months over the promised land, and they spent 40 years because they kept fighting the plow, and unbelief took over, and they didn't move in the promised land and wandered in the wilderness 40 years. I'm so tired of wandering in the wilderness. Let's move on over. Let's do it. It's going to come. It will not tarry. So maybe the plow is at work in your life at this particular time, and the fallow ground is being turned upside down. And God, the divine planter, is planting the seed. Can we wait? Can we experience it? There's a harvest coming forward. Biblical history is filled with example after example. Not only Abraham, Moses, but there's so many right now. And actually, we see in the scripture, in this case, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, about those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run, not get weary. Because he's a miracle-working God, and he wants to do this work within us right now. And whenever, we, like people in the scriptures, lay down like fallow ground, and they did that at times, and refused to let God move, he turned off his blessings, and then he waited for Israel to rise again to go forth under his direction. You see it happening in the Bible, people that did that, just kind of not moving forward, and, in your own life. So right now, the plow may be at work. It may be getting down in deep. It may be turning your life inside out, upside down. It seems like you receive a call from over here, and there's an area, a problem over in that area, and a problem in this area, and I just got to lay it all over to God. I say, okay, Lord, I'm having a hard time waiting on you, but you've promised me in your word, those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles, shall run and not get weary. And so, Lord, I want to do that. And do what Psalm 40, verse 1 and 2 says, I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me, heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit and out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on solid rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Though the path before you at this very moment may be uncertain. The trials and tribulations may be there. But let him put a new song in your heart. And watch him do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can ask or think. Does the past seem uncertain at this particular time, the journey on life? Does it feel like your life is being like a field that's being plowed and hurt and pain is everywhere and you're really having a hard time waiting? That's why we have to take another look at God's word here. Isaiah 40, let's back up here, verse 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths grow faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. What a marvelous promise straight from God's word. I want to encourage you to take a look at that verse there. Read it. Meditate on it. Go back here to Isaiah chapter 40, the last part of that chapter, and let it get down deep into your spirit. Because the power of God can come upon you at this time. It comes upon the people of God as they believe and they wait for God to move not only in their lives, but in the lives of the poor and needy around them. There's so many people that are hurting out there. Let's let God work through us to try to help them. Maybe they're right there in your own family, and you're having a hard time. You're just really trying to get through that son, that daughter, that husband, that wife, those that wait upon the Lord to renew their strength. So wait and pray, because the more you badger them, the more you try to change them, the worse you're going to make it. So you see a need. God's giving you insight to the need. He didn't give you that so you can badger them, harass them, nag them. He gave it to you so you can pray for them. Then Psalm chapter 9, verse 18 says, for the needy shall not always be forgotten, and expectation and hope of the meek, and the poor shall not perish forever. So you want to see change? They want to see change. But it's not going to happen as you continue to badger. In fact, we've got to stand on the word of God. Jesus tells us, John 14, 12, he says, behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in me, you can do the very works I do. Yes, even greater things, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever he asks the Father in my name, I'll do. For here the Father is. wanting to plant his seed in our fallow ground, or empty ground, so to speak. And the plow has come and turned things over, and he wants to let the fruits of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control take place in our life. And so as we get older, we're given that choice. Are we going to get better or bitter? If you're bitter because of the plow at work, you're not going to get better. You're just going to be fighting the plow all the time. But you'll get better as you totally surrender to him. When you feel forgotten and your expectations aren't met and you're having a hard time waiting, declare to the Lord. Declare to the Lord, as Psalm 119, verse 114 says, "You're my hiding place and my shield. I hope in your word." The Bible is called the Book of Hope. That's why we've got to get into that book. We've got to read that book. We've got to meditate on that book. We've got to take God at his word. He wants to unlock the limited in our life. He wants to unlock the unlimited in our life. Jesus said, "Ask, it shall be given you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you." That means waiting. Now, maybe you're like me, and you're hating the waiting. Then I have to just dig further into God's word and see what Jesus is telling me also in Matthew, that if I have a faith as small as a mustard seed, it can move mountains. And man, that's what I need right now. It's a mountain-moving faith. Pray for me, and I'll be praying for you. Oh, we can just stand on the word of God and believe God at this particular time, because again, the Word of God, the Scriptures, is God's book of hope. In it, we find the promises over and over. We find how to experience the power of God, the presence of God. It's affirmed over and over, and we're told in Isaiah 26:4 in the Amplified Bible, to trust in the Lord means to commit yourself to him, lean on him, hope confidently in him forever, for the Lord God is an everlasting rock. Yes, he's the rock of ages. Oh my, what a wonderful Lord we have, and what a wonderful book he's given us, and what awesome creation he's placed around us. So let's experience it. Let's let the rivers of living water flow over us right now at this time. Wash away the anxiety that says, I want patience and I want it now. Well, no wonder you're going through trials and tribulations. You learn patience. You learn how to wait as you go through trials and tribulations. So what do we do? There's times that I'll feel so dried out, tired out, burned out. I have to fall on my knees, begin to pray. And it's just like a great waterfall just sweeping over me. And I can experience this peace that passes all understanding. And he washes away the anxiety. And he lets his word go down deep in my heart. And he speaks to me like he does from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, where it says, faith is the substance of things hoped for. And without faith, Hebrews 11:6 says, it's impossible to please God, with the end result making it impossible to wait. So you need to get in the Lord's word. And maybe you're feeling really anxious at this time. I mean, you're hating the waiting. Fall on your knees. I keep a little mat right beside the end of my bed so I can easily just fall on my knees and just talk to God. And I'll go in the living room, put my head into the couch, and just pour out my heart to God. And I'll continue to pray. And sometimes it takes a while, and sometimes it happens in a matter of moments. I begin to experience his peace that passes all understanding. It's like I'm standing on that waterfall, just washing away all the worry, the anxiety, all the stuff that causes me not to wait on the miracles that follow the plow. So, again, into God's word we go, into God's word we go. So we have to, again, avoid being a people who fear the plow when it comes to break things up in our life. We'll have to learn to wait on him. And look for the miracles. Look for the little plants that are going to sprout and grow in a mighty way. Now, again, back to Isaiah 31, it says, those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. We don't want to wait. In fact, we'll do anything and everything we often can to avoid the plow. But the more we avoid the plow, the longer we're going to draw this thing out. It's the plow that's going to come in, turn things all upside down. And if all we want to do is live painless lives where the bills are paid and everything's fine, there's nothing upsetting the apple cart, we're just going to go through lives that, well, you know, be one of those animals in the zoo if you have to, and just see that you get fed every day, take care of them, live out your life, nothing eventful happens. But if you learn to trust in the Lord, and you learn to wait on God, that even when the plow takes place, and you may be going through it right now at this time, watch for the miracles that follow. Stand there and just totally surrender. Because if we don't, we won't see the miraculous. We often rather study the experience of others who wait and seek God than experience such in our own life. So we need to get back into God's word. And even though Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31 says, those who wait for the Lord shall gain no strength, if we don't wait, we're not going to experience it. We're not going to see it happen. So again, I tell you, we've got to learn how to wait on the God. I have to say that over and over to myself. You may be just listening in on a sermon that I'm preaching myself. Say, you need to wait on the Lord. And then here I am out here anxious again. So it's a constant struggle. And you know, it's often easy to just give up, believing that all these miracles happened in the past and they're not going to happen now. Well, that's not true. That's why we got to get into God's Word. That's why we got to experience it. How easy it is for depression to creep in when we feel the situation is totally hopeless. And that's why the Word of God, again, Jeremiah 29:11 has to get deep in our spirit. So he says, for I know the thoughts and plans that I have for you, saith the Lord. Thoughts and plans for welfare and peace and not for evil, to give you hope and a future. Now, I know those words were spoken to the children of Israel who'd given up all hope, but now you and I are under a new covenant through our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. These words apply to us today when we feel like giving up hope. I'm going to read that again. It says, for I know the thoughts and plans I have for you, saith the Lord. Thoughts and plans for welfare and peace and not for evil, to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29:11. Read it, meditate on it. Now, God wants to awaken us right now. The eye of our understanding. This was Paul's prayer for the people in Ephesus when he says that we might understand in Ephesians 1:18, by having the eyes of your heart flutter with light so that you can know and understand the hope to which he called you and how rich his glorious inheritance in the saints are, his set apart ones. He says, I pray that the eyes of your understanding be open, that you'll really know this hope he has for you. See it again, 1 Peter 1:3. Get the word down deep in your spirit. What does he say? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. There's hope, for Christ is risen. Get that down deep in your spirit that you know it. Now we got to learn how, in spite of hating the waiting, that he is there. And that not just some things, but all things went together for good to them. We love God and are called according to his purpose. That's what he's trying to tell us right now. So we have to learn how to rest in the hope of eternal life. And that's what we're told to do in Titus 1:2. Resting in the hope of eternal life, life which is ever truthful God, we cannot deceive, promised before the world or the ages of time began. If we begin to experience this, if we're going to experience the power of God, we just need to turn loose at this particular time. We got to come out of hiding, so to speak, trying to avoid the plow at all costs. And then also try to tell ourselves, okay, I got a problem buying yourself out of it. Some people believe that they just have enough money to take care of everything. But then in this uncertain economy we live in right now, those who think they've had some money and had it invested in the stock market or bonds and everything else, and the bottom opens up and drops out. So it seems that their world is falling apart. But Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he's still there like he was in the past before he had any money at all. So maybe it's gone, but he's the same. He will never leave you nor forsake you. All right, let's take a look now and move back again to Isaiah 40:31, where it speaks to the revival. Because there a revival that can take place in us. Because it says, those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. And it says, they will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. So let's back up here a little bit. Let's go all the way back to verse 27 in Isaiah 40 here. And where it says, Jacob or Israel, I'm going to insert my name. And I want you to read this verse later. And I want you to insert your name the same way I'm doing it. So whenever it says the word Jacob in there or Israel in there, we're going to put our own names in, okay? And we're going to take a look at that. And we're going to do this in the Message Bible. So are you ready? Let's do it. Okay. Now here's what it says. Why would you ever complain, Larry, or whine, Larry, you can put your name right there then, saying, God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me. Don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's the creator of all you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired, doesn't pause to catch his breath, and he knows everything, inside and out. He energizes those who get tired, gives fresh strength to dropouts, for even young people tire and fall. But those who wait upon the Lord get fresh strength. They spread their wings and soar like eagles. They run and don't get tired. They walk and don't lag behind. Wow. There it is. Now you go back and reread that and put your name in there where we see the name Jacob for Israel. And again, I was reading out of the Message Bible. And then let it just get real personal at this particular time in your life and let it speak to your heart. And stop telling yourself you're getting old and that's why you're tired. Come on, you're as only as old as you feel. And you're strengthened the Lord day by day. He will give you that supernatural strength where you can do exceedingly abundantly beyond what you can even ask or think. So instead of getting hung up in the past, wrapped up in the bitterness of the pain of the plow of the past, let Jesus, the living water, just flow over you at this time. Wash away first your sins, as many as call upon the name of the Lord, that shall be called the children of God. And then go through your past, wash away those the bitterness, the hostility, the hatred, the times the plow tried to do its work and you became angry at whoever was pushing the plow, that God was using at that moment. Let him wash you clean at this particular moment. And, you know, just begin to hear and see the birds. It says that we trust him like the birds. They neither sow nor reap, yet your heavenly Father takes care of them. But the flowers, and spring coming, and all the flowers that are there, remember that? They are beautiful than all Solomon's wonderful clothing. And your heavenly Father takes care of them. Won't he much more so take care of you? So again, let's get in the Word of God. As I indicated, you may be hating the waiting, but let him do his work right now. Even the trials and tribulations and the waiting we endure on a day-to-day basis can build character in us and hope within us as we look to our risen Lord. And that's what we see in the Word of God. So now let's journey over to 2 Corinthians 4, 17 and 18, where it says, "For our light momentary affliction, the slight distress of the passing hour, is ever more and more abundantly preparing and producing and achieving for us an everlasting weight of glory beyond all measure, exceedingly surpassing all comparison, all calculations of vast transcendent glory and blessedness never to cease. Since we consider and look not to the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen, for the things that are visible are temporal, brief, and fleeting, but the things that are invisible are deathless and everlasting." That's from the Amplified Bible, and the Lord does amplify some of the different verses. And basically, what is it saying? It's saying real things, the things that are really taking place, are often the things that can't be seen. They're happening out here in the unseen world. You can't see what God is doing at this particular moment. You may not be able to see him there carefully planting that seed in your life after the plow has gone through over the fertile ground. You may not be able to see it. You may not even be able to see the things that are sprouting up around you. And that's where faith comes in. In the same way, the farmer has to have faith that when that seed's put in that ground, that there's a miracle taking place in the unseen area, that the seed is germinating. If he keeps digging up the seed and to see if it's really growing, he's going to kill it. God, that's where faith comes in. All of life, all the principles. When Jesus taught about the kingdom of God is at hand, he'd use so much of creation at the sower, the seed. He gives example after example through creation around there. The parable of the sower, the seed. There's so many different parables out here that he used. And how we have to trust God. And God's trying to create good soil, not hard soil that the seed falls on and maybe sprouts up for a moment. And then the birds of the air eat it before it even sprouts or withers and dies. The ground is broken up so that the seed can germinate and take root. And again, if you can remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord right now, you can wait and look for the miracles following the plow. They're going to come. And you may have to wait and tarry for a moment, but the vision at the appointed time is going to come. Believe God. Stand on the promise of the Lord. Look at his word over and over and over. We're looking at the word of God. Glory be to God. There's his infinite mercy, love, and grace revealed through sending his only begotten Son who took our sins upon himself, who died on the cross, who rose from the dead. Listen to what he says in Psalm 27:14. Wait and hope for and expect the Lord. Wait and hope for and expect the Lord. Be brave and of good courage, and let your heart be stout. Let it be firm and enduring. Yes, wait for and hope for and expect the Lord. Wait, hope, and expect. And that miracle is going to follow in your life. You know it. It's happened in the past. I have to remember it right now, though, because a plow is painful. And it often it seems things seem so uncertain. It's so easy for me to relax on that fertile ground where everything is there, but this weed's growing and junk coming up and the real seed that needs to be planted isn't taking place. But the plow does its work. So I wait, I hope, I expect, and I look and I see the miracles that are following. That's right, Romans 15, 3 tells us that may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust him so that you may overflow in hope for the power of the Holy Spirit. God is calling us and telling us to hang on at this time, to believe him, for Christ is risen. There is hope. So let's wait. Let's look for the miracles following the plow. Father God, we're coming to you right now. And Lord, we're telling you like the psalmist did, it hurts. How long, oh Lord? I believe you're telling us not long. We got to look to you, Lord. I know it at this time in the name of Jesus. Lord, I want to look for the miracles. I want to expect the miracles. I want to hope for the miracles. They're going to follow these plows that are doing stuff in my life right now. And I ask that you do the same for my brother and sister within the sound of my voice. We're believing you for miracles now, for your miracle-working God. And Lord, we're looking for the miracles that are going to follow the plow. We're waiting for them, Lord. You are true to your word, and we're receiving them now. In the name of Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.